Well, welcome. Good morning. On a nice, sunny, brisk morning here in Winnipeg. My name is Jim Mulvale. I'm Dean of the Faculty of Social Work here at the University of Manitoba, and I'm part of the small but mighty organizing committee that put together today's event. We're very pleased you can be here for our symposium on basic income. I'll just make a few announcements before we get into the program. It was interesting organizing this event. We actually kind of came together late in 2014 and but worked hard and put things together as quickly as we could to have for today's program. There was really great interest in this topic, more so than we anticipated. In fact, in terms of the capacity of the room and the number of seats, the event filled up 2 weeks before today, so we actually developed quite a long waiting list of people that were interested in coming, but we had already filled up. So that was certainly encouraging for us. I've been involved in things over the years where you worry about getting enough people, enough souls in the room to call it an event, but we had quite the opposite experience. Great interest in basic income. So we're very pleased you could join us today. We're pleased about, we have a very kind of mixed group of people from the community, people from the university, faculty, students, people interested in social policy questions as active citizens and interested in social justice questions. And I realize some of you may have had more exposure to the idea of basic or guaranteed income than others. So to just kind of give you, for those who are relatively new to the idea, reading about it, we did insert a one-page kind of description of guaranteed or basic income into the program. So that'll give you a quick definition and a kind of an overview of the two main models that are talked about for basic income, negative income tax and the demogrant model. So that will kind of help kind of establish some of our the definition of basic income that we'll be working with today. Just so I don't forget later, I just wanted to thank the people who helped put today's event together. I mentioned the organizing committee, and their names are actually on the back of the program, people from the University of Manitoba here. I also want to thank, I don't know if they're in the room, the two people that kind of are handling all the registration and logistics. If they're at the back of the room there, Bria Henderson and Jody Petch. Want to give us a wave? They really were great help in organizing things for this morning and for today's program. I also want to thank the Manitoba Institute of Policy Research. They're actually sponsoring an event with Jurgen De Wispelaere this evening, Policy Pizza and a Pint downtown, but they're also, they worked with us on this event in the planning and provided the wherewithal that we can tape the sessions, partly to accommodate the people that weren't able to register due to the big response to the event. The speakers are going to be videotaped and their talks will be available on YouTube after the event. I also want to thank my colleague in the Faculty of Social Work, Sid Frankel. Sid and I kind of do research together on basic income, and all the organizing committee pitched in, but Sid did yeoman's work to coordinate all the details and get everything lined up for today, so thanks to Sid as well. Just in the way of, just on the program as such, I just wanted to make, draw your attention to one correction. This morning on panel one, the two speakers in that panel will actually be Evelyn Forget as listed, but also Harvey Stevens, who mistakenly was slotted into the afternoon time slot at 2:50. And Wayne Simpson will be speaking in that spot. So basically it's a switch in the speaker's orders between Harvey Stevens this morning in panel one and Wayne doing the presentation at 2:50 this afternoon. This was Wayne's teaching schedule as such that he couldn't be here in the morning. Just around housekeeping, we'll have coffee coming in at around 10:45. There'll be lunch in this room at just after noon. The washrooms are actually downstairs. You have to find your way down to the lower level. There's a stairway over here and also the stairways over this way. And both washrooms are just off the cafeteria in the lower level. And there's actually some other washrooms down there too if you happen to cross them. Okay, I think that's all in the way of introductory remarks and housekeeping. So without further ado, I'd like to get into the program because we've designed today's program that everybody's going to give a talk on various aspects of basic income and looking at the question from different points of view. But we've also want to build in kind of questions and answers and some discussion on the topics that people are presenting on today. So we'll get right into things so we have time for questions and answers after our first speaker. So I'm really happy he's our speaker from the farthest away, the fellow sitting up here in the front with me, Jurgen De Wispelaere. Jurgen is very well known in basic income circles. He's had lots of involvement over the years with the academic journal, Basic Income Studies. He's published widely on basic income in a variety of forums. He's currently at the he's currently a fellow with the Institute for Health and Social Policy at McGill University. He's got a background in political philosophy and disability policy, adoption policy, as well as unconditional basic income. So we're really pleased he's with us here today. I think he'll have some stimulating and thought-provoking remarks. And without further ado, I'll turn the podium over to Jurgen.
I see a design flaw. I have to move around. So, first of all, can you hear me if I talk like this far for the taping and things? So I'm very, very bad for cameras because I tend to move around a lot. So the last time I got taped, I saw the video afterwards and you can see me kind of popping in and out of the screen. So if that happens, you're welcome to try and stop me. And I emphasize try. I'm not saying I'm actually going to stop, but. So first of all, I really want to thank Jim and Sid and everyone involved in setting this up. I talked to Jim about not having been in Winnipeg, half a year ago, and he said, well, we'll have to have you over. And I thought I was gonna, do the usual and have a chat with, five people in a room. And then apparently he's now working me 2 days straight. So thanks very much for that. I hope it's value for money in the end. I'm really very excited about this whole event, the whole series of events really. And as I said, it's the first time in Winnipeg, so that's like one thing scratched off the bucket list, so that's great. I'm sure it's the same here, but in Montreal, we always like to find excuses to escape for the winter. My colleagues are really laughing that I chose Winnipeg to escape Montreal winter. So next time I suggest, we really have to, we have to set up a group in Hawaii that invites us over on a regular basis. I think that's gonna be our next strategy, right? So, okay. So one thing I want to say before I get into the topic, so I come from a philosophy background, right? So it kind of comes with a health warning, right? So many people think that philosophers are these wise men who ponder questions and then come up with very sensible answers. And I don't know where you get that from, because it's absolutely not true. So here is what philosophers really do. Philosophers basically are like, let me give you an example. It's like, imagine that you have these kids, these six-year-old kids, and you leave them alone with your laptop or your phone, and you leave them alone for 2 minutes, and you come back, and it's like taken apart in 25 different bits and pieces. You can't put it together anymore, okay? You need to watch these kids all the time. They're very destructive. Philosophers are like that. You know, you throw an idea at them, any idea, an argument, they play around with it for 30 seconds, 1 minute, you won't recognize it again, you know? It comes up in different parts, you can't put it together, you won't like it anymore, okay? So philosophers basically come with a serious destructive edge. There's a reason why we don't run the world. Plato came up with this argument saying that philosophers were supposed to rule the world. Luckily, the world decided against Plato. It's very good for you guys. Actually, now the lawyers are running the world. It's not necessarily that much better, but, you know, still. So I'm not going to actually talk about philosophy, but I am going to do slightly destructive things. Okay, so one of the things I want to do is I'm very much into complicating things. Now, I hope it's not unnecessarily complicating. But one of the things, and this is kind of the thought behind the talk is, we end up thinking about basic income as this very simple proposal. Philippe Fampares once wrote about basic income as the beautifully, disarmingly simple idea. And in one way it is, but it's actually kind of doing us a disservice because behind the simplicity, it actually gets complicated very fast. And I think we should really start paying attention to the complications. So if we want to have this basic income do what it's supposed to be doing, if we want to have it really on the agenda, we start need to take complexity kind of seriously. And especially when it comes to politics. So in a nutshell, my talk is basic income may look simple, but the politics is pretty complicated. That's very much the fundamental insight, okay? What I wanna do is I kind of sort of wanna say a few things about the framework, and then I'm kind of gonna run you through various sort of examples that I've been working on. Some of that is stuff that being published and is very well thought out, or at least I think so. And some of it actually is things that I've really started thinking about just now. So I'm kind of throwing out some stuff to you guys as well and see what sticks, if anything. So without further ado, the unbearable simplicity of basic income. Okay, so I like fancy titles. I couldn't make up my mind which one, so I just keep them tossing them in there, right? So I want to start by talking about kind of two perspectives on politics. So the first one is to say that basic income politics is really difficult, you know, and we all know this. I mean, you know, we end up talking to people. It's often sometimes very hard to convince people. Okay, there are people who are convinced already, but if you really want to argue to people about basic income, giving free money to people in a sense, you're gonna meet a lot of resistance, right? Okay, so, you know, and then we have these sort of strategies where we really wanna persuade people. We wanna come up with evidence in some sense or form. We wanna come up with arguments, and it's all very focused along one dimension, okay? That's the difficult part, and it's hard work, absolutely true. But I think what we're missing is the second point, which is basic income politics is not just difficult, it's actually complex. What I mean by complex is that it has different dimensions, okay? They all interlock, they all interact in very complicated ways. Each of these dimensions interacts with aspects of the world, of the policy, of the economy, of the politics in complicated ways. And when we start, you know, in some sense, working on promoting basic income, we often focus on one of these dimensions. And as we're focusing on one of these dimensions, sometimes there's a lot of stuff happening behind it. There's a lot of stuff happening on the other dimension that we haven't, you know, we don't control necessarily, okay? So we need to really think about basic income as multiple layers, all the different sort of design elements, you know, and some of these are very straightforward. Basic income is universal. It has to capture everyone. It's supposed to be unconditional. It's supposed to be uniform. It's supposed to be individual, not household-based. And there's many, many more different things going on, talking about different levels, talking about how it's integrated in policy models, whether it replaces certain programs, and so on and so forth. It gets complex. Each of these are dimensions, okay? And as you're trying to settle on one, it actually has an impact on all the other ones, okay? That's complexity. So one thing, and I mentioned it at the end here, is some of you might be familiar with this. This is sort of Lon Fuller's, This is Lon Fuller's idea of policy as a polycentric problem. It's a problem that has multiple centers. And he has this very, very nice little image. So think of policy as a spider web, okay? So it has all the different strands. The moment you put tension on one strand, the rest of the web start wobbling around as well, okay? And he actually has this, which I kind of took it out by accident, but he has this thing where he says, imagine that you put too much pressure and one of the strands breaks, and then, you know, everything gets reconfigured. So it's not just the fact that you have simple effects, it's the fact that when I put some pressure on this side, the pressure on the other side might double or triple, or, you know, or something might break, and then pressure moves there, and so on and so forth, okay? And Lon Fuller's idea was basically to say that, look, polycentricity means that, you know, we need to have strategies that, you know, try as much as possible to, you know, to capture what goes on globally, globally meaning not in the world, but with the whole dimensions of the policy. And we need to be very aware of all sorts of trade-offs, okay? So we might want to say this is the best thing for that very particular aspect, but then it might not be the best thing for the policy in general. So complexity really matters. So this whole idea of basic income being simple, to my mind, just doesn't really work. Okay? So that's kind of my thinking. I mean, it's, you know, it's kind of sky in the pie, general kind of framework thing, but I hope you get the gist of it, right? So I think the bottom line is, I think when we talk about politics and all we think about is how can we convince this politician or how can we convince some of these people, I think we're really missing out on how complicated this policy really is and how it ties in with so many features of the system that are already fixed in various ways, okay? So what I want to do in the rest of the talk is basically run you through kind of three types of examples. The first one is about beneficiaries, okay? So here is a very simple idea. We often talk about basic income as in, basic income is good for these people and these people. It's good for the disabled, it's good for women, it's good for the poor, it's good for this, and so on and so forth, okay? Leave aside for a moment whether you actually know that that's the case, okay? Because I think, you know, we're rapidly, well, I mean, I think we have good reasons to think this, but we're rapidly pretending that we have evidence and we don't necessarily have that, okay? But here is the big point. The fact that someone or some group is a beneficiary doesn't make it a constituency. So when we're talking about the politics of basic income, what we're really interested in is, you know, who are the people that get a really strong interest in basic income such that, you know, they become politically interested in basic income? And that's a very different game. Okay? And I think in many ways we haven't really thought about this very carefully. We just keep banging on about basic income is good for this and this and this. And, you know, but that doesn't necessarily mean anything until we can actually translate this in political capital. Okay? So that's the general idea. So who are the basic income beneficiaries? So basic income beneficiaries is a policy category. You know, we try and figure out who the effects are. I mean, you know, we try and calculate, say, well, these people's lives is better, and so on and so forth. Now, one of the interesting things here, and people often make a lot out of this, is that, well, basic income, everyone is entitled, everyone gets it. Well, that may be true, but that clearly doesn't mean that everyone is a beneficiary, right? I mean, we know this. I hope you know this. Actually, you'd be surprised, but within, you know, a lot of the basic income Twitter and Facebook and web blogs and things like that, you still come across this idea that clearly basic income is good for everyone because everyone gets it. Well, no, because, you know, somehow, of course, a lot of it gets taxed away for some people in order to fund it for the other people. So, you know, it is redistributive in that sort of sense, okay? With, you know, unless, of course, you have a scheme like Alaska where, you know, you have a very particular kind of scenario. So the first problem that we have is, you know, so what is the real size of this benefit? And then, you know, you can't just say this in general, right? I mean, to say that this is good for disabled or women and so on and so forth, you know, one reason we can't really say this is because it very much depends on things like the level. It depends on whether it's, you know, built on top of existing programs or whether it's supposed to replace programs. So we need to have all that sort of information, okay? But my point really is that even talking about that is not enough, because we need to think about the constituency, which is not a policy category, it's a political category. And so, first of all, we actually know that a lot of the people that we think this will benefit, unfortunately, are not the politically strongest categories, okay? I mean, and sometimes even worse, I mean, you know, some of the people that probably would benefit most, I'm thinking, for example, you know, one very particular group that I think definitely would benefit from a basic income, if we can reach them properly, would be the homeless. The homeless are a non-political entity, right? They're not sufficiently organized, you know, and politicians basically pretty much don't care. Yeah, they care in one sense, but not really. They just don't feature in the political game, okay? So we need to keep in mind that distinction. It's fine to have a beneficiary, but, you know, we need people who are generally politically active. And then there's a second question that I want to actually talk a bit about, which is this sort of, what would be the political impact of the fact that it's universal on, you know, even non-beneficiaries? So here is the idea. We know that everyone gets a basic income. We know that that doesn't mean that everyone benefits. But is there a sense in the fact it being universal, nevertheless having sort of a political quality to it? And I kind of want to, this is where my destructive nature comes in, I kind of want to ruin that for you a little bit. So anyone who thinks that this universality is great because everyone gets it, therefore, you know, there's good political reasons once we have it to keep it. So I'm going to ruin that for you, sorry. So here is an interesting standard view. I mean, those of you who are into, you know, welfare state research and stuff are very familiar with this. Universalism is good because it captures the middle classes. You capture the middle classes, you have a very firm basis of, you know, of a policy being kept in place, being protected, and so on and so forth, right? So you know, there's this, Corpi and Palma have this famous argument where they basically say, you know, you want to target the poor, you want to do something for the poor, you want to go universal because you keep the middle classes in there, and the middle classes will protect the policy that's good for the poor. And in many ways, you know, people have argued that basic income is doing precisely that. Everyone gets basic income, okay? Why do we give basic income to the rich and to the middle classes and the well-off? Well, it's not for the well-off, it's for the poor, okay? So the question is whether this really works. So first of all, the middle classes clearly are not a net beneficiary, you know? I mean, I guess you can come up with some level of basic income where that might start working, but that's not the sort of scheme that in any way is feasible. I don't think so, right? So the one that we're really talking about, the middle classes really are not a net beneficiary. And if you think that the middle classes can be deluded into thinking that they're a net beneficiary, which some people seem to think, then, you know, I think we're kind of missing the point here, right? So and the biggest problem that we have actually is this second point. So Peter Baldwin in the like early 90s wrote a really great book about sort of, you know, sort of historical stuff on the welfare state, looking at Sweden and Germany and so on. And one of the things he basically found is that the sort of solidarity that keeps a welfare state going partly depends on the fact that people actually can't identify each other as beneficiaries or payers, you know, net beneficiaries or net contributors. So one way in this works is that, you know, through all these complicated tax systems and programs and so on and so forth, you know, it looks like everyone kind of gets something, but we don't necessarily know what it is that we're paying for and whether I'm paying for Jim's basic income or not and so on and so forth, okay? And the biggest problem with basic income is that it exactly does that. So the very simplicity of a basic income means that we actually know pretty straightforwardly who is going to contribute and who is going to benefit. And you know, Jim, in the little note you have there, has the two different versions, the Demogram model and you know, refundable tax credit model. And especially the refundable tax credit model, you can see very easily, in a sense, who becomes the net beneficiary and who not. So if basic income is very clear of who wins and loses, then, you know, if the Baldwin argument is right, then we have a problem. This universalism kind of doesn't really get us to the politics of it, okay? And in a sense, the smaller the class of net beneficiaries, the more it's targeted, ends up being targeted to very specific groups, the more of a problem we have. Because the more, in a sense, these are groups that can easily be shoved aside, right? So the larger, in a sense, we have net beneficiaries, there's going to be all sorts of links. I mean, think of this in the following way. I might be a middle-class person, don't have a benefit myself, but, you know, my neighbor is disabled, who I know, and so on and so forth. They might benefit. I know some other women who are taking care of the children and elderly people, and I see that they benefit. So the more beneficiary groups you have, actual beneficiary groups, the more kind of networks you can see appearing. That might be one possible argument, okay? But as some people have argued, we have to sort of start with a small basic income or a basic income that's very targeted. Well, that runs the risk precisely of going against this universalism thing, okay? So my point in a sense is that even although basic income looks universal, on the politics side of it, it just doesn't go through, really, right? There's a further problem, which is, you know, which actually is, there's quite some evidence on this based on the sort of the Nixon family plan. Brian Stainsland has a very, very interesting set of articles and books on this. And he basically talks about symbolic contamination or cultural contamination. And he basically says, so the gist of the point is that even the people who are net beneficiaries sometimes don't want to take policies because it comes with a stigma attached to it. So our argument always has been, basic income is not like that because it's universal, everyone gets it, there's no stigma attached. But that doesn't make any sense. I mean, stigma is not just, I mean, it's partly of how you run it through the implementation and how you run it through the rules and the games, but it's not just that, it's how people interpret it. Now imagine a basic income which effectively only benefits a few categories, right? I mean, what is to stop people from saying that, look, I'm sorry, but you know, you can call it whatever you want, but it's still a handout to these people, and that's it. Because we're contributing, and it's just these people who are benefiting. So symbolic contamination, again, you know, first of all, some people, even the people who are benefiting, might actually be against it and say, look, I'm sorry, but, you know. So I've talked to some people in the disability community who think that. Basically say that, look, this is just another way to put us aside. Just give us proper jobs and that's it. Just forget about this sort of stuff, okay? I don't care that, you know, in some sense it would alleviate my poverty is the wrong sort of mechanism for this. And of course, politically, again, we have a problem, right? So it just starts building up on the same point I made earlier, right? It looks universal, but it really isn't in that sort of sense, okay? So that's so far beneficiaries constituencies. So you know, so you see, this is one example of where, you know, the unbearable lightness of simplicity kind of sort of thing, or the unbearable simplicity of basic income becomes a problem. We need to dig deeper and we see that there's a lot of complexity there. There's a lot of stuff that we start to have to take really, really seriously. So now I wanna talk, now I wanna talk about the other side, not just beneficiaries, but about, you know, the sort of politicians, organized groups, and so on and so forth. And I have two big problems with the way we often think about how we build our coalitions, right? So the first one I call the problem of cheap support, right? So the problem of cheap support is kind of like a numbers game. I've been going to basic income conferences. I think my first Bien Congress was 98. And from then on until now, every time you keep hearing these people, yeah, we're in the right direction because, you know, this guy is in favor and this guy is in favor and this guy and this group and we have these. And, you know, the Greens are in favor and what is it, your premier? The leader of the Conservative Party here is in favor. And, you know, you can come up with a huge list, right? I think we can all come up with a list. It's like this person in favor, and so on and so forth. So great, we have support. So one way to think about this is let's just, you know, and as long as the list grows, we're good. We're going in the right direction. So I have some serious, serious issues with this, okay? So we see, it's true, we see there's a lot of talk about support in all these sort of things, but effectively all we're measuring, if we're measuring anything, is just someone saying, yeah, I kind of like this. So what do we do with that? Well, not much. Okay, so my idea basically is that without a follow-up commitment to actually spending political resources, this is cheap support, as in it means bugger all to us. Can I say bugger all on camera here? Yeah, there you go. Well, you can always, you know, do you do editing or so? And political resources could be many, many different things, right? I mean, it could be, you know, actual organizational stuff, spending time and money campaigning, you know, building, getting involved in building coalitions, but also, you know, think about this in terms of, you know, once it gets to the sort of the actual policy agenda stage, you know, people have to kind of think in terms of which of the policies I'm going to really invest my time and my effort. So is basic income going to overrule some other policy? We'll see about that, okay? So many things in that kind of sort of bag. But unfortunately, I think sustained commitment, we really don't really have. We just have cheap support. And there's another problem as well, actually, which is we often get support from people who don't actually even have a capacity to do this sort of stuff. So here are sort of two examples. I mean, in the European Union, and it is the same here kind of, but you know, I'm kind of getting fed up with people always telling me, the Greens are in favor, the Greens are in favor. Who cares the Greens are in favor? I mean, I like the Greens fine. But on the political front, it, with a few exceptions, the Greens have very, very little to contribute in terms of getting anything on the agenda. Very sorry to say, okay? It's a reality. They're usually very small, marginalized parties. And, you know, so in some sense, the capacity just isn't there. The will might be there, but the capacity isn't there. And we need to, you know, we can't count a Green Party member saying, I like it, the same way someone in an actual coalition says, I like it. You know, we need to kind of discount these things. Trade unions actually is a very interesting example as well, because trade unions, what you see is some support it, some don't. Here is the interesting thing. The trade unions that support it are usually the small ones, or the ones who are operating in a system where they actually don't really have any policy power. The trade unions who either operate in a system where they play a big role or who are really large, they're not the ones who are going to favor basic income. So, you know, and you can check this. I mean, you know, check your support of trade unions and then see, you know, whether these people really have any sort of impact. So we have a problem. You know, cheap support is support either without commitment or willingness or without the capacity thing. Now, you might say, hold on, Jurgen, you're just being your usual destructive pessimist kind of thing. You know, we should step back here, because of course some of these people support now, and maybe now they're marginal, but who knows, you know? I mean, Syriza just by miracle won the elections in Greece, so stuff like that happens. You know, Podemos in Spain apparently is very much on the run of becoming part of the government. So, you know, things like that happen. So perhaps the Greens at some point will be in government. And actually the Irish Greens, for example, were a part of the coalition a number of years ago. So, you know, so perhaps I'm being too pessimistic on this. So my problem with that argument is that you're just assuming that because people are supporting now that they will be supporting tomorrow. You're assuming that political support is sticky. Well, it isn't. Okay? And one of the reasons why it isn't is because support is cheap in another sense. It's cheap for us, because it has no value, but it's also cheap because if you don't have any policy responsibility, it's no cost. So it's very easy for people to say, yeah, I'm in favor. I mean, I'm in favor of, you know, colonizing the moon. You know, whatever. It doesn't matter. It really doesn't matter. The point is that the moment these marginal groups become part of a coalition and a responsibility, you know, then it becomes costly. Then they have to put their money where their mouth is. They have to start devoting political resources. And then you see the commitment problem coming in. And you see suddenly basic income disappearing off the agenda. And actually, you know, and this is standard political rationality. It actually makes sense. I mean, they have to make hard choices between many different things they have to talk about. You know, and basic income, they probably rightly think might be too controversial, so let's focus on something else, okay? Podemos in Spain recently just did that. They literally launched an economic program and basic income disappeared out of it. So, you know, for a year and a half, they were always talking about basic income. They have a lot of basic income supporters in their party. But now that they're actually getting to the point of becoming electable, it disappeared. The Greens, the Irish Greens I just mentioned, you know, talk, basic income. The moment they got into the coalition, silence. Okay, François Blais in Quebec, you know, we big, you know, points about, we've got a basic income supporter in the Quebec government. So, I mean, you know, he's a very nice guy. He wrote a very good book, but it's not doing anything, right? I mean, Quebec's not going to have a basic income any moment. I can tell you that. So, So, you know, and you can even find sort of, you know, kind of interesting strategies of downgrading. So in Ireland, we had this really, you know, I mean, great move where Cori, the Irish sort of religious pressure group, was really pushing for the government to take basic income seriously. And at that time, Ireland had the social partnership agreement, so it was like a corporatist system. So Bertie Ahern, the Taoiseach, basically told the Cori people, so look, okay, fine, we'll do a green paper, we'll study it. You know, it's like a commitment to study this stuff. The, you know, Cori was great. I mean, for, you know, 10 years on, I think Sean Healy and Bridget were like doing the tour and saying that Ireland will be having a basic income soon because the government's having a green paper. It's on record. So what happened? We had the green paper, the government commissioned an economic study. Economic study said unfeasible, government dumped the whole program. But it was brilliant strategy, right? I mean, it was like, you know, Bertie Ahern managed to basically give the basic income advocates what they wanted, and there was no cost associated whatsoever. But of course, you know, no effect really either, right? Okay. I won't mention Brazil. We can do that in the question thing. I need to move on. How am I doing on time? Oh, I'm actually okay. Good. So this story hasn't ended yet. It gets even more depressive, right? So I want to talk about toxic cheap support. So here is one of the problems. When we play the numbers game, it's like, yeah, people here, people there, and so on and so forth. They're all supportive. It looks great. You know, we're one happy family. Kumbaya, kumbaya. So here is how politics really works. So one faction will be in favor of basic income, and another faction says, you know, I don't want to work with these people. Or, you know, or they use the basic income to really identify themselves. And this is like, you know, we don't want to kind of confuse ourselves. You know, I mean, we need to kind of set ourselves apart. So we're going to separate things out. So there is a sense, I mean, I'm not saying this plays everywhere, but you can find examples like this, but there is a sense in which we kind of have a first mover disadvantage, I call it, which is, you know, if as a basic income movement, we just hitch our card to the first group that comes along, you know, we may be lucky in the sense that that group becomes capable and is committed and so on, but we may be very unlucky because if this is a group that is incapable to really push the program or doesn't really want to, but has sort of captured the niche, the market in a sense, with basic income. One of the effects might be that it actually deters some of the other groups, right? And I think this is a genuine problem. And it actually, you know, I call it marginalization by association. So even, you know, even groups who think that basic income is sensible enough, they just won't touch it because it's become toxic by association. So here are sort of two examples that you can find in the basic income thing. There's quite a lot of groups across the world who, you know, very strong kind of religious groups who promoting basic income. So in Namibia, for example, the basic income experiment that they're always talking about, the pilot, is basically run by a church, right? And there's a lot of church groups associated with it. Ireland, again, Cori was the conference of the religious in Ireland, was a group that, you know, first of all, is basically like a pressure group of the Catholic Church, right? So very strongly religious, although the people in charge, like Sean Healy and Bridget, a priest and a nun, but they weren't, it's not like they were wearing their religion on their sleeve. It wasn't like that. They were just talking about skin cold. But you can't get away from the fact that they effectively represent the religious organization. I lived for 6 years in Ireland, and I talked to people there, and people were surprised to think that there was a non-religious basic income idea out there. So, you know, so people really had this idea that you kind of had to buy in the basic income and in the religion kind of thing at the same time. And in Ireland, we had an extra problem because, you know, around 2008, when a lot of the issues came out with child abuse, Cori turned out to be the organization who was actually involved in trying to negotiate a settlement with the government and the victims. So one of the smartest things that Bridget and Sean Healy did was they kind of sort of moved the basic income thing out of Cori and set up their own little group. But of course, you know, Ireland has 4 million people. They've all seen Sean Healy on television many times. I mean, you know, he's not going to fool anyone, right? So now the website doesn't look as is full-on religion, but, you know, we all know that what's going on there. So my point basically being is that, you know, if you're tied in with this religious group, nothing wrong with that as such, but it will deter some other people. Good reasons or bad reasons, it doesn't matter. It's going to put a, you know, put a wedge in there. Another example is, you know, people are making a lot of, you know, Roland Duchatelet is an entrepreneur in Belgium who set up this political party, Vivant. At the time when that happened, it was like, oh, you know, great. So this is basically a rich guy who funded his own party, and basic income happened to be one of the things he really liked. Götz Werner in Germany is doing the same, right? This is, you know, this is one of the wealthiest people in Germany who happens to be a basic income supporter and is very happy to support all this stuff. But they're liberal entrepreneurs looking at basic income from a very particular perspective. So you can imagine anyone who comes at this from a more radical socialist, whatever kind of perspective, is not necessarily going to have the same affinities, right? So again, people are very worried. They might like basic income, but they don't necessarily want to work with these guys, okay? So those are two examples of basically, you know, sort of toxic, cheap support and so on. It's actually not that, I mean, the last examples might not be that cheap. I mean, these entrepreneurs really, really put a lot of money into it. But nevertheless, it's a hurdle rather than an assistance in some way at some point, right? And, you know, the proof's in the pudding of the eating. Germany and Belgium don't have a basic income at the moment. So, you know, I mean, that's not really fair, but, you know, I got to say it anyway. So here is the interesting bit about the logic of cheap support. The very reason why our support is cheap, for us, no value, is also the reason why it's so easy for these people to give it, right? So there's a really, you know, they're kind of trapped, because the moment, in a sense, that the support becomes more costly for people to give it is also the moment when a lot of them will disappear. So, you know, so if we play the numbers game and saying that what we care about is adding people to the list of support, inevitably we're kind of tied into, you know, more and more cheap support. And you know, my claim is that it's not really helping us that much, okay? I want to just very briefly say something about, is there an escape out of this? So there actually is an interesting kind of sort of approach out there. This really kind of goes back to the late 60s, early 70s. So Manker Olson basically is a guy who was looking at pressure groups and basically saying that, look, why is it that people, you know, I mean, we have these collective action problems. You know, people want to join a group to pressure for a particular policy or a particular change. But actually, you know, why would you want to join a group and spend all the effort where you can just sit at home and wait until this group does all the work for you and the policy benefits us anyway, okay? Why should I go on the streets and, you know, militate in favor of basic income, support the movement, do all this? I can just sit at home, watch Homer Simpson episodes, and, you know, if basic income comes around, I'll have my basic income anyway. So it's a classic free rider thing. Cheap support is a little bit like that. It's very easy for people just to say, yeah, sure, but there's no commitment. They're free riding on that bit. So Manker Olson basically said that the solution to this is that these organizations also have to provide selective benefits. So this, for example, is why trade unions, who, of course, in some sense, you know, argue for minimum wages, which affect everyone, usually also have benefits specifically for their members, because they want people to join up, okay? So how do we do this? Well, I don't think we have the resources to provide material benefits. One argument sometimes is that, you know, if it's continued collaboration, that's sort of an incentive as well. But, you know, if we're talking basic income as a one-off thing, we're not talking about continued collaboration in that sense, right? We're not going to talk about doing other projects with the same people after. Reputation might be something. So reputation, I think, is an interesting one, but again, you know, I'm not entirely sure how far we can push this. But if there was a way in which we could shame people, you know, basically first attract them into supporting and then afterwards shaming them if they, you know, either withdraw support or not. So, but one of the things is that, you know, we then need to think about, so, you know, who are the people that they would be worried about if they get shamed into doing this and so on and so forth. So I have no answers here. It's just like a direction of perhaps thinking about trying to resolve this, okay? I've got a second problem, and how much?
10 minutes.
Oh, that's fine. This is a little bit somewhere. So cheap support is a problem already, right? So I have a second problem. It's not me, is it? No, okay. Oh, okay, good. So the second problem I call the problem of persistent disagreement. And again, it runs into one of these myths that kind of runs around in the basic income movement where we, you know, we say very easy, simple things and it just doesn't work like that. So this is the idea of the grand basic income coalition. So the starting point is here that, you know, one of the amazing great things, and it's so brilliant, is the fact that basic income is supported by everyone on the left and the right and, you know, religious groups and the Greens, and not by everyone in these groups, but we have support across the barriers. So we're not tied into thinking as this as a left strategy or a right strategy and so on and so forth. And this is great, you know, we just need to build on this. And you know, many people have, and I just put up a list. It's like, you know, Brian Berry, Malcolm Tory, who runs the CIT, the Citizens Income Trust in UK, Guy Standing, Vampires, Suplicy is amazing that way. I mean, you know, he writes to you know, in the newsletter and saying that he talked to George Bush back in the day, and George Bush mumbled something vaguely affirmative, and he's like, great, we have George Bush in our camp. It's like, we're all like, we don't want George Bush in our camp. Thank you. But Suplicy is one of these guys who's like, you know, it doesn't matter who you are, anyone can sign up to it, you know, again, kumbaya, and it's so great that we can bridge all these sort of things, right? So, and again, you know, if only, right? If only it were to be that simple, that easy. Unfortunately, it isn't. So my view is that political disagreement is really deep and is persistent, right? We can't really get away from it that easy. So I see basic income not as one proposal, but as a family of proposals, right? And the moment you get into the details, there's a lot of different models. There's a lot of decisions you have to make. I mean, think about the level. Are we talking about sort of poverty line level? Are we talking about below that? Those are effectively sort of two different models. Are we talking about, you know, different ways of implementing? Again, the distinction that, you know, is in that little flyer, the negative income tax version or the demo grant version, okay? Are we talking about fully unconditional, or perhaps do we allow some sort of small compromises? You know, we can, each of the design dimensions, you can have different variations, and effectively, you put all these things together, you just get a whole bunch of different models. So the interesting things is that these models, they're, I mean, this is not just about rules, right? I mean, they actually do things. So you implement this model versus that model, you're going to have a different distribution of who wins and who loses. Okay, in you know, in this model, some people are going to be a bit better off here. In another model, some people are going to be a bit better off there. Think again about debates about the level of the grant is the most obvious one. You know, you pitch it higher, there are going to be more people winning, in some sense. You know, and of course, some other people losing because someone has to pay for it and so on. Right. So that's very straightforward. Now, political factions will have very strong views on these models. They will care about who wins and who loses. Okay, so this sort of agreement, in a sense, that we have behind the basic idea of basic income, in some sense, just masks disagreement that we have about which precise model of basic income. And that can go political very fast. So, and to use the sort of the distinction between, you know, the left, the right, the progressive and the conservative version, I mean, you know, conservatives, for example, will typically insist on a lot more replacements. Okay, a lot more social programs being replaced by basic income. They're happy to have a basic income, provided a lot of these other programs are taken out. On the left, on the other hand, we tend to have this idea of, you know, we use basic income as a ground floor, but these other programs still have to go in there as well. But that's a fundamentally different view. It's not that easy to come to an agreement on this, right? So I'm not saying it's not possible to compromise. What I'm saying is that when we talk about sort of this grand basic income coalition, we don't even talk about these things. It's like, oh, we're all in favor of basic income, but we're not really. I mean, these are difficult, hard choices to be, you know, that have to be hammered out at some point. And they will appear, right? Because, I mean, they won't appear if basic income just stays pie in the sky. But the moment this actually moves onto the political agenda, I mean, this stuff comes back and with a vengeance, right? Right away. So in a sense, so here is the sort of idea that people like Philippe Van Parijs put forward. They say, actually, you know, okay, we can accept this, but you know, but look at it dynamically, look at it over time. And you know, what we want to do is we want to have some agreement on basic income in principle, And then we kind of lock people into this. You know, so the moment the conservatives and the progressives both agree, then that's the first step. And then, you know, they have this sort of idea that then naturally it will develop into the progressive version. And I don't know where they get that from. I mean, as in, you know, I wish it was true, but I don't see what would be natural about the basic income developing in a version that the progressive camp favors as opposed to one that the conservative camp favors. And actually, as I'm going to show in a minute, there actually is an argument that it might be the other way around. That there's actually, you know, in some sense, the conservatives might have the advantage here. And I'll explain to you in a minute. So here is an example. I just wanted to sort of put this in the context. That some of you might be familiar with the idea of a participation income, which was basically a basic income in the sense of being individual, being universal, but not fully unconditional. We just want people to do something. It can be very broad participation, you know, but we want to sort of avoid people just sitting on their sofas and not doing anything. And, you know, the argument, Tony Atkinson, who proposed it, basically said that, you know, it makes it politically more feasible because the one thing people don't like is the free money thing. If we take the broad participation, it's not free money, and yet it captures a load of people. So it's a lot more inclusive. It's a good step towards the full basic income. So Philippe Amparés always said, you know, he wants a basic income, not a participation income. But he basically thinks, look, participation income, we start with that. And then, you know, we rapidly see that the administration becomes a bit too complicated and people will happily just move into basic income. So it's the two-step approach. First, we lock them in and then it goes to the full version. But why think that? Why not think that, you know, once administration of participation, and just think about this for a moment, you know, if we take sort of participation seriously, you know, if for example, the fact that you take care of your elderly parents is something that gives you participation income, it also effectively means that the state has to check on you whether you really do this, right? So at the administration of participation income is a nightmare. That's absolutely true, okay? So I agree with that. But what I disagree with is the fact that that means we immediately go into basic income, because it's very easy for the state to say, well, given all the extensive costs of participation income, let's go with the categories that we already have, education, formal employment, perhaps some official care kind of stuff. So before you know it, participation income becomes restricted instead of expanded. Okay? It's equally logical. I mean, you know, the state can go both ways. It's a question of politics. So we can't be naive thinking that it will smoothly roll out into a basic income. And so here is actually, I think, the biggest problem that we face, and with we, I'm saying, from the progressive side, right? So if you think that getting this grand coalition on the ground will naturally lead you to progressive basic income, we have the following problem. At each step, the progressives have to fight for every move. So, you know, we lock basic income into a sort of the, you know, a sort of a basic model, some compromise model, and we want to get it to the full progressive version. So, in some sense, the, you know, each time the progressives have to fight and fight again and spend resources. So every time there's a shift, there's a battle, right? All the conservatives have to do is basically say, you know, veto, right? I mean, we're just going to block things. Now, blocking things politically is a lot easier than moving things ahead, right? And this is the fundamental problem that we have. The conservatives, in some sense, are precisely happy with this sort of much more minimal kind of thing, and it's the progressives who want to push. And it's the fact that they want to push that makes it harder, that they have to push in order to get their version, that makes it harder. So the bottom line of this is that I don't think the dynamic approach can guarantee us that we're going to go to the progressive version, right? So it's a risky strategy, right? Now, you could say, well, you know, but at least we'll have a basic income. It's better than what we have now. You know, it's not what we want, it's a compromise. But let's be serious about this. I mean, is it necessarily better than what we have now? So here is two ways to think of it. People sometimes think of this as like, we have a basic income as in, you know, it's on the, you know, it's on the table, it's in the legislation, and so on and so forth. And, you know, it's there, as in it's sort of, you know, we can trace it back in the text, the relevant text, and so on and so forth. But that's not how I look at basic income. I mean, I look at basic income in terms of its effects. What can it actually do? okay? And then we might actually end up in a situation where, you know, to be honest, in some cases, you know, there might be versions of basic income that make people worse off than what we have now. We should be very open about this. Let me tell you a little story. Some of you may have picked this up, but the UK Greens, a few weeks ago, you know, they're running up to the election, right? So their economic policy was going to be basic income. It was a big thing, you know, and they were like, the leader basically started promoting it all over. She went on one of the news programs, and they started hitting her on the numbers. Now, it turned out that their proposal was like, I think the number was something like, whatever, 38% or something. For the 38% worse off would be worse. So the people at the very bottom that it was supposed to help would actually be worse off with their proposal. And the people, so this is the, you know, I mean, it's an amazing story. The actual people who found and had to, you know, open up and say, look, your proposal is wrong, is actually the Citizens Income Trust. They did the actual hard work with the modeling, with the data, and they found that the Green proposal was flawed. So here is the basic income group in the UK having to, you know, tell the one party that was going to propose a basic income that, you know, what they were proposing was, you know, was worse than what we have. So, but it exists, right? It's real. And in this case, it was just stupid, as in, you know, these people really didn't do their numbers. But, you know, if we're going back to the progressive conservative thing, we may end up with a compromise that the conservatives are happy about, but the progressives think is worse than what we have at the moment. You know, think about a scenario where, as part of the compromise, we do dismantle some of the social programs. And then all the conservatives have to do, in a sense, is have to block the level of basic income, you know, because basic income would have to be updated over time in terms of real value. All they need to do is, you know, I mean, just look at what's happening in the US, right? Every time there's a budget, all the Republicans there have to do is no, and we're done talking. I mean, and this is the nightmare scenario that I have a problem with, okay? I mean, I'm not saying it's going to happen. You know, I don't want to be that pessimistic. There's a reason they put me in the first, right? So now after you're going to have a lot of optimistic people, and, you know, you'll come out being very happy. But generally, you know, we need to take this politics just very, very seriously. We can't just sort of think about this as, oh, it's great, it's simple, and it's this, and it's like, no. Get down to the nitty-gritty and think about, in some sense, the worst-case scenarios and how we can avoid those, right? That is the key point. I mean, my view on this is that, you know, we should really be worried about the reliance of a grand coalition. I tend to think we should be clear about the red lines, about saying that this is the policy. You know, sure, we want to compromise. You know, politics is compromise, but there are certain things we don't want to compromise on. And if the conservatives don't want to go with that, or other groups don't want to go with that, then so be it. Then the time is just not right. You know, then we have to work in another way to try and build a coalition. Okay? I think that's it. I think I'm done. Okay. I mean, in a sense, I mean, so, and I like this George Lakoff work as well, right? So it's actually, you know, I mean, it's like me, it's depressing but very stimulating. So I hope so, at least. So here is the interesting thing. Within the basic income movement, actually, people have been doing this moral category thing, right? I mean, Van Parijs, and Guy Standing and all these big guys, they really go around talking about justice and rights, right? And really trying to frame it. I mean, you know, Standing now talking about the precariat, I think, is a very good way of framing things, right? So, and really thinking about this as rights and justice and so on and so forth. So we have that moral language, somewhat. We're still in competition, of course, right? We're still in competition with the other moral frameworks, but it's not like we're just relying on facts and evidence. In some sense, the biggest problem I have is that the moral language thing works up to a certain extent, but we need to complement this with a really clear idea of how we design things fit into the exacting sort of the institutional structure. So here is one of the things that follows from that. I think we need to kind of give up talking about basic income in the abstract and talking about basic income, you know, across countries as if it's all the same stuff. I mean, you know, a basic income in Canada versus the US versus Belgium versus Spain is going to partly be a very different discussion. And I think we're going to get a lot of that later on today, and I was very happy to see that. So we're going to have a lot more discussion about how basic income could work within Canada or within Manitoba. And I think that's essential. So in some sense, I want to say we need both. We need to find the moral language, but I think we're partly doing that on basic income, but we also need to do that other part of the work. And I think in many ways, that's where a lot of the rub is. Okay? But thanks, great question. So there is I don't know whether you're familiar with this sort of notion of pre-distribution, which has kind of been trotted out a bit now, right? So it's actually you know, it's something that was invented more or less by, you know, Jacob Hacker, who's a very, very interesting scholar at Yale. But it got picked up by the British labor leader, Miliband. And so pre-distribution for a while became this thing. And so the argument is, you know, basic income is not just redistribution, it's pre-distribution. We give people assets in advance, and then, you know, they can kind of play their role, and so on and so forth. I mean, there's several things to be said about that. The first one is that I think, in a sense, basic income is both anyway, right? So I think, you know, there's a sense in which that distinction kind of overlaps. But kind of going back to the previous commentator, I mean, the pre-distribution thing does allow you to frame basic income. You know, and talking about prevention does allow you to frame basic income in a very different way. Because it's kind of hard, you know, it's very easy for people to be against redistribution, but it's hard to be against prevention. I mean, prevention kind of seems to make sense, right? So one final point to this, then we need to be clear what it is that basic income is preventing. And then we do get into things like evidence and stuff like that. And then we get into the problem that we actually, you know, as I said before, we don't really know that much about basic income for a very, very simple reason. Because, you know, at the moment, basic income just doesn't exist anywhere in a way that, you know, we can draw immediate lessons. I mean, people often point out Alaska. But, I mean, if you look at Alaska, it's such a unique system, right? I mean, we're talking about a grant of whatever it is this year, whatever, $1,500 or something like that, once a year. It's not the sort of thing we're talking about when we talk about basic income. So the effects in Alaska is going to be very different than, you know, if we were to implement it. So, but again, I think today we're going to be hearing a lot more about what we do know about basic income. But I like the prevention idea, but inevitably it's going to lead us into questions about, you know, how much do we really know, or how much do we have reason to suspect, right? Sorry, that's a long answer, but good question.
Just a footnote for those who may not be familiar. The Alaska dividend is money paid to every resident of the state of Alaska out of the oil and gas dividends and resource dividend or revenues that come into the state. So it fluctuates depending on prices, but I think it's about roughly $1,000 per person per year.
Yeah, something like that. So, yeah. But it fluctuates quite a bit, actually, over time. Yeah. So.
Okay, we have time for a few more questions.
I mean, you know, very good question, and you know, huge things to say about this, right? So let me just make a few small points. Think back, for example, about you know, healthcare reform down south. I don't know whether this is south. I keep pointing that way, but it could be, you know, wherever south is.
It's back in Montreal.
Sorry. Oh, yeah. So okay, then we're there. I guess. No. Okay. Healthcare reform. One of the most famous things that happened there is that how long it took for, you know, and even now, people who are clearly benefiting being resistant to it. I mean, it's incredible. It's actually incredible. Like, you know, you can show them, and these are people who are actually sick. You know, they're suffering, and yet they resist these sort of things. So, I mean, you know, it's very hard to get your head around this, right? Mm-hmm. And I mean, in a sense, I worry that one of the reasons why simply, you know, pointing at the benefits might be a problem is because of that, right? It's part of that. And it kind of ties in a bit with what I was saying about this symbolic contamination, right? So it's not just, so the idea that, for example, students might become poor and then at some point suddenly going to jump to basic income depends on, in a sense, kind of overcoming whatever it is that's driving that. It also, of course, depends on being very clear about having a model of basic income that effectively makes them better off, right? And I think we still need to show a lot of that as well, very clearly. And so here is the intriguing things about the different groups. I mean, imagine that the best possible basic income for each of these groups may be quite different, right? So the basic income that benefits disabled people might be a different basic income from the one that benefits. So people, for example, who propose that we do this group by group have a little bit of a patchwork problem and saying that, look, you know, I mean, perhaps there's things we can do there, but then the moment we then want to harmonize it into a thing, are we not creating losers again? So which actually gets to the point of timing and sequence, which I think is a very interesting one. I think generally we have this worry that, you know, now's the time, we need to jump on it. It's like this bandwagon thing. Again, you know, I was at the Bien Congress, my first one, 98, and already then people were saying, now's the time, 2 years later, now's the time, you know, it keeps being the time. So assuming that will go on, perhaps the thing we should do is really, you know, I guess what people are doing now, build community organizations, build networks, build up our capacity, explore this carefully, build up our evidence, and then, you know, kind of be ready the moment there is a genuine opportunity and we have the capacity. So,
yeah.
Great, thanks. Well, first of all, you know, thanks very much for the sort of antidote about now's not the time. I mean, I appreciate that. I really do. I'm not just saying that. I mean, there is a sense in which, you know, it's always the same. I mean, we don't want to necessarily jump on the bandwagon because of the bandwagon, but we don't want to get caught up in this sort of now we can't do anything and so on and so forth. So I have no problem at all with people being enthusiastic, right? What I have a problem with, or you know, if we want to be enthusiastic, let's also be smart about it. That's my point, right? So I'm very thrilled about the huge amount of media attention that Basic Income has been getting in the last 2 years. What I'm worried about is that we're kind of squandering it if, in some sense, we don't move the discussion at a higher pitch. And we just kind of, you know, there's a lot of sort of, you know, again, maybe I just went to too many of these meetings, but as like a lot of these meetings is like, you know, we're all sitting in a circle, sort of patching each other on the back, saying, I don't know, oh, don't we have a great idea here? And it's like, so, you know, we need to move things ahead, right? And, you know, there certainly is a time to do something. I'm not sure what. I mean, I'm just a philosopher raising issues. So, you know, I'm happy to leave it up to the more positive people to come up with things. As for investment, I think, yes, absolutely. Very interesting perspective. Not very easy to link to the prevention point as well, right? Absolutely, absolutely right. So the question then is, how can we look at different groups, different coalition partners who are really, really interested in this investment approach and are going to put the money where their mouth is and really push it forward? So happy to, you know, I think very interesting perspective, and we can work on that. Okay. Interestingly, a little side note, and then I'll leave it to Sid. Anna Reid, who was the past president of the Canadian Medical Association, was at the big conference in Montreal last summer. And one of the points that she was raising was, you know, the huge costs that ill health is causing us. So, you know, so if we were to find fully, properly, as we think at the moment, that, you know, we seem to think that we have good suggestions that basic income would have a serious health premium. I mean, you know, from an investment perspective, that seems a doddle. The question, of course, is to convince a whole bunch of people to look at it this way, right? So, are we done, or did
I
cut off?
I think we do
Sid,
have
or?
To wind up now.
Right.
I just wanted to thank you for your thoughtful questions.
Sorry, Sid.
Sid had a question, but I'm sure we'll get a turn later, too. But I just wanted to thank you for your thoughtful questions. Thank Jurgen for his stimulating remarks. We'll adjourn now and reconvene at about 11:05 for the next session.
Can I just say one thing? The cheap support and disagreement thing is a paper that's coming out very soon. If anyone is really interested in it, I would say, do you have contact or maybe email Jim? And I'd be happy to pass it on. Okay, so I mean, I'm always happy to promote myself and
we'll do
the
some
cause
talking
as I go along.
And kind of talk about how to get some of this material readily available after the conference.